HarperCollins presents What a Flanker by James Haskell. Read by James Haskell. The best revenge is living well. Foreword. When news broke that I was writing a book about my career, I felt a great disturbance in the rugby community, as if millions of voices suddenly cried out in terror. But do not fear, I won't be throwing anyone under the bus in the coming pages. Well, maybe a couple of people. But if this book fails and hundreds of unsold copies are pulped, I will atone by having the resulting porridge reconstituted as a trestle table in a home for battered rugby players. What follows is not a blow-by-blow account of my life. You won't find out where I was born, Windsor, the name of my first pet, Jet, as in Jet from TV's Gladiators, or the name of my first school, Papawick. But you will find out which bastard always skimmed the top off the fruit crumble before Wasps games. Why props are still so fat. I've no idea, to be honest. Unacceptable. And what the hell went wrong at the 2015 World Cup. That's right, there is some serious stuff as well. I'm well aware that I've always been like Marmite. Oh, for God's sake, why him? Not my words, but those of Ireland legend Rory Best on hearing that I've been picked for the Lions. But I hope this book shows that I always gave my all for club and country and just wanted to have a bit of fun on the side. I do hope you enjoy. And to the man who stuck a bottle of beer up his arse and did a handstand on a boat, thank your lucky stars I didn't name you. Chapter 1. When Team Socials Go Wrong. The Boat Trip, Part 1. There's no getting away from it. She's lost control. Like that old Joy Division song, confusion in her eyes that says it all, she's lost control, and she's clinging to the nearest passerby. When I say she, I mean me, because I'm standing on a boat in a wig and a dress, a woman for the day, a skipper in drag witnessing a full-blown mutiny. And when I say skipper, I don't mean skipper of the boat. He's the 60-year-old bloke cowering behind the DJ decks, whose jam-jar glasses can't hide the terror in his eyes. I mean skipper of Wasps, one of the proudest rugby union teams in England. So, in truth, I've got no passers-by to cling to. I'm meant to be the boss, the governor, the rock. People are supposed to be clinging to me. Fat chance. We've only been drinking for a couple of hours, and already I'm thinking, you're Captain Bligh, and that bloke over there with his pants around his ankles, doing a handstand on a chair with a bottle of lager up his arse, is Fletcher Christian. This is going to get ugly. That's the problem with academy kids. They always get giddy and feel the need to impress their teammates. There might have been a time, doubtful, when a young kid, wanting to impress his teammates, quoted an inspiring passage from Shakespeare. Once more unto the breach, dear friends, but not nowadays. Instead, they do handstands with bottles of lager up their arses. A week in hell, with the devil's little all-black imp stamping all over my testicles, could not have prepared me for what happens next. The academy kid flips off the chair and back onto his feet. The bottle of lager exits his arse like a bat out of hell, closely followed by its former contents, closely followed by a jet of excrement. The bar ladies below deck have a particularly good view of this literal shit show. They're screaming and are saucer-eyed, clinging to each other as if they were 10 miles out to sea and under attack from the dreadful spindly killerfish. The vessel skipper is open-mouthed. I think I can detect a solitary tear running down his cheek. If this were a scene in a movie, he'd rip the needle off the record and silence would ensue. Instead, people are running in all directions and retching over the side of the boat. Time to muster as much gravitas as a 6'3", 19-stone man can while wearing a wig and a dress. I chuck several fucks into the arse lager shit magician and tell him to clean up his mess, before rushing below deck, apologising profusely to the bar ladies and grabbing a bucket, sponge and some jiff. As the academy kid is on his knees, scrubbing the deck clean of poo that should by rights still be up his backside, I think to myself, what a tragic episode. But we must carry on. An essential release. I know what you're thinking. How can professional sportsmen be so unprofessional? How can an England international allow such shenanigans to go on in his midst? I sometimes think the same. Then again, you try keeping control of a squad of professional rugby players let off the leash after a long, hard season. And let's face it, young men are known to be quite daft. Groups of young men, even dafter. And groups of young sportsmen, dafter still. But perhaps a more compelling explanation for professional sportsmen's occasional lapses in professionalism is because they spend so much time being professional. Being a professional rugby player is bloody hard work. It involves a lot of sacrifices, getting battered and bruised in training and on match days, repeated blows to the head, snapped and twisted muscles and broken bones, eating the right things, drinking the right things, keeping strictly to the rota, going to bed early and hardly ever going out. It's not like working down a mine. We love it and we get paid well, but it takes its toll, physically and mentally. So the odd team social serves a purpose. It's an essential release and a bonding experience, not much different to a miner having a few pints in the pub with his mates on a Friday night. There are two main ways a team bonds: by suffering on the field together, in training and on match days, and by sharing nights out together. I look at team socials as like a play or a film. Not that anyone else would want to watch it, but they are a little piece of human drama for those that take part. Team socials have their heroes: the teammate, normally Danny Cipriani, who walks off with the most beautiful woman anyone's ever laid eyes on. They're anti-heroes: the teammate who sticks a bottle of lager up his arse, does a handstand and shits himself. And they're villains: the teammate who punches someone for no good reason. There are the jokers: the teammate who can destroy a man with a single quip while reducing the rest of his pals to eye-watering, stitch-inducing laughter. The fools: the teammate who gets drunk, falls over and suffers a comedy injury. The foils: the teammate who kneels behind a man who gets pushed over, preferably into someone's garden. The eternal victims: the teammate who spends all night chatting up a woman, only to get custard pied again. The stock characters and bit part players: the teammate who passes out in the toilets after a couple of tequilas or is found curled up under a table, mumbling about mummy. A great team social has comedy, farce, absurdity, cruelty and tragedy, and preferably some singing. I hesitate to compare rugby players to soldiers. God knows those boys and girls do a more important job than we do, but there are similarities in the way we behave when we're not on the front line or field of play. Team socials for soldiers and sports people are about building camaraderie. They're about creating a communal history. Team socials top up the well of comedy so that the lads can keep going back for laughs time and time again. Professional rugby players, like players in any team sport, are adults who never stop laughing like children, because nothing in the world bonds a team better than laughter. I must have laughed 100 times every single day for 18 and a half seasons. Everything I did, and I did a lot of stupid things, I did for the story. It's like that line delivered by Jeremy in Peep Show after Mark has made a tit of himself again: at least you've got a funny story to tell. All I ever wanted was to sit at the back of the coach, swap stupid tales, and make people giggle. Abominable visions. I've never really recovered from my first proper team social. I was a teenager playing for Maidenhead when we went on a tour to France. The clubhouse coffers must have been a bit bare that year, taking in the exotic rugby outposts of Boulogne and Calais. I was just about old enough to have the odd shandy, if I asked nicely, but the dads in our group, excited beyond belief at being away from their wives for a couple of days, were under no such restrictions. And when groups of middle-aged men are away from their wives and under no restrictions, things often go horribly and disturbingly wrong. One traumatic evening, I was wandering around the hotel, no doubt bored and wanting a piece of some action, and heard an almighty racket coming from the bar. Curious, but also slightly scared, I gingerly pushed the door open and was greeted by the sight of my father dancing on a table, as naked as the day he was born. The abominable vision shocked me to the very core. You can't unsee something like that. Your father, legs splayed, backside exposed for all to see, cock and balls swinging in time to some banging Europop. I caught his eye and then quietly closed the door, hoping no one else had seen me, and sloped off to bed. We never spoke of this episode, but it's why I haven't been able to look him square in the eye for the best part of 20 years. Sometimes I wake up in a cold sweat, having revisited the scene in my dreams. I'll start muttering to myself, the horror, like Marlon Brando in Apocalypse Now. Such a disturbing experience might have left a more delicate soul scarred for life. But when I finally came of age and it was my time to get involved, I dived right in. No holds barred. Full tilt, right in the thick of it. A psychologist might deduce that my unbridled enthusiasm for team socials was a coping mechanism, me trying to assert control and take ownership of chaotic situations. Or maybe they'd just say I was a bit of a dickhead. Not that I had much choice. Just like no one had a choice back then. It was drummed into me from the very beginning that team socials are as integral to rugby as scrums, lineouts, and filling a teammate's shoes with shaving cream. I was still at school when I went on Wasps pre-season trip to Poland, a fresh-faced 17-year-old about to enter the upper six. And while I was a bit nervous about the training side of things, I was terrified of what might happen if we were allowed a night on the beers. I'd been told about some horrific initiations, including the time Lawrence Dallaglio was dangled by his ankles from a balcony by Dean Ryan and his captain Mark Rigby. It was only when one of the other back rows, Francis Emerua, a softly spoken giant who put the fear of God into everyone, told them to stop that they did so. I dread to think how hard Emerua was, because Ryan and Rigby were no shrinking violets. Lawrence would have been a teenager, like me, so I had sleepless nights thinking about all the things that might happen to me in the Polish boondocks. We were in Poland for 10 days, training 4 times a day, with 1 evening off, but that's all it takes. Some brain box had organised a trip to Auschwitz the following day, so the plan was to go out for pizza and a few beers. I didn't believe in drinking when I was at school. I ran the school bar, but never took advantage because I thought it would affect my fitness. So I told myself I was going to turn up at this restaurant and stay well out of the way. I hated hangovers with a passion. They killed me. And who wants to be hungover at Auschwitz? The last place in the world you want to be hungover is at Auschwitz. Are you even allowed to be hungover at Auschwitz? But I soon learned that trying to stay out of the way at a rugby team social is like trying to avoid punches from Mike Tyson while stuck with him in a phone box. So there we were, a few of us younger players tucked away in the corner of this open-air restaurant come nightclub. And over Swan's first team fly half, Alex King, holding 2 pints of lager. And the first thing King ever says to me is, "Haskell, Lawrence doesn't think you can drink. Show him you can." Not only is Lawrence the current Wasps captain, he's also the godfather, not doing much apart from lurking menacingly and sending his foot soldiers on various errands with the message, "Make him an offer he can't refuse." I think, let's just get this over with, grab a pint and chin it in one. 5 minutes later, Fraser Water swans over and says, "Haskell, Lawrence doesn't think you can drink." Another pint chinned. 5 minutes later, Paul Volley swans over. Same chat, same outcome. 5 minutes later, Josh Lucy swans over. 5 minutes later, Simon Shaw swans over. After about 6 pints, Lawrence finally deigns to swan over himself. "Good to see you drinking," he says, with an evil glint in his eye. "Have another one." Now I'm absolutely steaming and starting to panic. Do I make a tactical retreat? No, that's not a good look. Just grin and bear it. But what about Auschwitz? "Never mind Auschwitz," says Mark Denny, all 2 of him. "Have another drink." There followed a kangaroo court session, beloved of rugby teams all over the world, during which Peter Scrivener, forever injured, won the Stealing a Career Award, and Josh Lucy won the Most Likely to Get Shot by Your Own Side Award. But after about 10 pints, I was feeling very dusty indeed and had to be rescued by Sean Edwards, chief deputy to Wasps head coach Warren Gatlin. Sean grabbed me by the scruff of the neck and said to me, "Right, kid, I'm taking you home." But to get home, we had to walk through the woods in the dark. So now I was shitting myself because I found Sean scary even when I was stone cold sober. Mercifully, I made it back to the barracks, which is what our accommodation was, located my room and found Rob Howley, the great Wales scrum half, shirt off, shredded to the bone and eating jelly babies on his bed. I remember thinking, I thought these people were elite professionals and all this guy appears to eat are jelly babies and toasted cheese sandwiches. Rob, clearly not a fan of Polish food, had even brought his own Breville toasty maker and a bag full of condiments. The room, which had no windows or air conditioning, was like a sauna. My mattress felt like a Jacob's cream cracker, and we'd run out of water. Well, I'd run out of water, was too scared to ask for any of Rob's, and too drunk to venture out of the room. As a result, and despite my colossal alcohol intake, I had the worst night's sleep ever, a fitful few hours of tossing and turning, punctuated by terrifying thoughts of how I might disgrace myself at Auschwitz and the odd beer-fueled nightmare. When I woke up the following morning, I could still taste cheap Polish lager, and Rob Howley was on his second bag of jelly babies. All I could think was, I can't go to Auschwitz. I'd like to go to Auschwitz. Actually, that's a lie. Auschwitz is not a place you ever want to go, but it's somewhere I feel I should probably go. Whatever I was thinking, my immediate desire was to stay in bed for as long as possible. But realising that that probably wasn't going to be an option, I dragged myself out and went in search of the only person more drunk than me the night before, Garth Chamberlain. Garth was the same age as me, but even less experienced at drinking. In fact, before that trip, Garth had never touched a drop. So when the boys made him drink, it was like taking a wrecking ball to a temple. When I tracked him down, He was cowering in the shower, sobbing. Through bubbles of phlegm and snot, he explained that not only had he been made to drink 10 pints, he'd also drunk tap water, so was wrestling not very well.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.